Let us start by considering a very small system of linear differential equations, namely a single linear ODE, which can be also written in this form. And the second form makes clear that y of t equals b over a is one particular solution of this differential equation. Because if you insert this, you see that the right side equals zero, and then y dot equals zero, and the solution stays constant at the value of b over t. So this is a solution that does not change over time, so it is a fixed point of this differential equation. A more general solution is given here. C times exponential of at plus b over a. It is easy to verify that this is a solution simply by calculating the derivative and then inserting this into the differential equation. Now we see that bA cancels out, and then we have CA exponential of AT on both sides. So we have verified the solution. And this actually is the general solution. There are no other solutions. The only free parameter of this solution is C, because B and A are given by the parameters of the differential equation. This solution is either an exponential growth or an exponential decay around the point or around the value of b over a. Here you see various examples of such a solution. All the solutions above b over a have a value of c greater than zero. All the solutions below b over a have a c less than zero. All the solutions that decay over time have an a that is less than zero, while the others have an a that is greater than zero. The red and the pink solutions differ in the magnitude of c. The red solution has a larger c than the pink solution. The magnitude of A has an influence on the rate at which the solution either grows or decays. So a solution with a small a would grow slower, even if starting from a larger value. So the gray solution would be one with a positive but very small a. And you see that on the left side it starts actually at a high value, but it grows very, very slowly. If you set C to zero, you actually get the constant solution. A system of linear ODEs is conceptually very similar, just with more functions and with more equations. Sort of a canonical form would look like this. And this has been rearranged in a way where each equation has just one derivative in it, and of course each function only appears once because it's a linear differential equation, so it can always be rearranged that way once you have only one derivative per equation. Typically, you have as many equations as you have functions. This is a standard form, but maybe not the initial form, so your differential equation might first come in a different way. For instance, like this. What you can then do in order to transform it into the standard form is you can subtract or add a multiple of one equation to another one. So in this case you would simply subtract the second equation from the first equation, yielding. And then you can replace the first equation by the resulting one. This example also shows that any of these factors a can be zero. In this case, a to 1 would be zero, which is maybe easier to see if we move y2 a little bit to the right. Once transformed into the standard form, we can conveniently write this system in vector notation. Y dot equals ay minus b, with y of t being a vectorial function, a matrix, and b a constant vector. Since we have as many equations as we have functions, a is a square matrix. Solving a system of linear differential equations is greatly simplified by the superposition principle. This principle makes two statements. The first one is that the general solution of the inhomogeneous differential equation can be generated by taking one particular solution of the inhomogeneous differential equation and a general solution of the homogeneous one. The second statement is that if you have two solutions of a homogeneous differential equation, then any linear combination of these is also a solution to the differential equation. Let me illustrate this here by an example. So here you see on the left side the inhomogeneous differential equation and the homogeneous one. On the right side, you have first y0 as a solution to the inhomogeneous differential equation and then y1 and y2 as solutions to the homogeneous differential equation. According to the superposition principle, we can now combine a solution by taking the particular solution y0 and a linear combination of the two solutions y1 and y2. Inserting this solution into the inhomogeneous differential equation yields if we now rearrange the terms, we get and because y0, y1 and y2 solve these equations up here, we see that any of the three terms equals zero. Which proves that the combined solution yt is actually a solution of the inhomogeneous differential equation. Since we consider linear combinations of the solutions y1 and y2, it makes little sense to use a y2 that would be a scaled version of y1. So y2 and y1 should be linearly independent. They should be different solutions. For a system of linear ODEs, there are as many linearly independent solutions to the homogeneous system as there are number of functions or number of equations. So if you have found for a system with, let's say, 5 equations and 5 functions, if you have found 5 linearly independent solutions, then the combination of the particular solution and these 5 solutions is the general solution of the inhomogeneous system. It's important to note that the particular solution cannot be scaled with a prefactor alpha 0 or something. So that always has to be the solution, the one solution that one has found for the inhomogeneous system. So when solving a system of linear ODEs, one usually first finds a particular solution of the inhomogeneous system, and there one usually picks the constant solution because that is very easy to find. Then one considers the homogeneous system and finds as many linearly independent solutions as there are equations, respectively functions, in the system. And then one knows that one has a general solution of the inhomogeneous system if one combines the particular solution of the inhomogeneous system with the linear combination of the solutions of the homogeneous system. And by tuning the linear prefactors alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., one can generate any solution that is possible for that system.